Pretty Simplified. Today we are going to discuss about cholesteatoma. So from the name itself, cholesteatoma, so in the ending we have oma. So what we'll conclude that it is any kind of tumor, but it is not a tumor. It is just a misnomer. It is nothing but, cholesteatoma is nothing but abnormal. It is abnormal skin growth behind eardrum. It is just an abnormal skin growth behind eardrum. It has two part. Cholesteatoma has two part: a matrix and a central white mass. Central white mass. This matrix is consists of keratinized epithelium, keratinized squamous epithelium. Whereas this central white mass consists of keratin debris, which is formed by matrix, that is this part formed by matrix. So this central white mass is also called as keratoma and also as epidermosis. So what is cholesteatoma? It is not a tumor. It is an abnormal skin growth in the middle ear behind eardrum. It has two part, that is a matrix and central white mass. Matrix consists of keratinized squamous epithelium and central white mass consists of keratin debris formed by the matrix itself, and it is known as keratoma, also called as keratoma or epidermosis. There are many theories about how this cholesteatoma origins. So we have many theories. We'll not talk in details, just the brief about which theory implies on which pathology about the origin of this cholesteatoma. So we'll discuss now the theories of origin. The very first is congenital epidermal cell rests. This is seen in the congenital form of cholesteatoma. Then second theory is called as Wittmaack's theory. This theory says that cholesteatoma occurs due to invagination of pars flaccida. Pars flaccida is a part of tympanic membrane. What does invagination means? If any organ, if it is growing inside first and then going outward, that is inside out, or it is taking a U-turn along itself, it is called as invagination. So Wittmaack's theory, which says cholesteatoma occurs due to invagination of pars flaccida. Then we have Habermann's theory. This theory says that cholesteatoma occurs due to epithelium invagination. Then we have the fourth, that is Riedel's theory. It says that cholesteatoma occurs due to hyperplasia of basal cells. basal cells. Then the last theory, that is Sade's or Sade's theory. It says that it occurs due to metaplasia. Cholesteatoma occurs due to metaplasia of middle ear mucosa. This cholesteatoma is classified as, so these are the theories, five theories: congenital epidermal cell breast, Wittmaack's theory, which says it occurs due to invagination of pars placida, Habermann's theory, which says it occurs due to epithelium invagination, Ude's theory, due to hypoplasia of basal cells, and Sade's theory or Sade's theory, which says it occurs due to metaplasia of middle ear mucosa. Now, the cholesteatoma is classified into two types, mainly into type. So the classification, it is usually basically of two type. First is congenital, and second is acquired. In acquired, we have two types. First is primary, another one is secondary. What is the difference between primary and secondary? In primary cholesteatoma, we have no previous history of otitis media or any perforation in tympanic membrane. Whereas in secondary cholesteatoma, we'll see previous history of perforation of pars tensa. This is suppose a tympanic membrane, this area is pars tensa. So previous history of perforation in pars tensa. So this was about cholesteatoma, its theory, classification, congenital and acquired. Let's discuss something, how this genesis, the pathogenesis of congenital and acquired cholesteatoma occurs. First we'll talk about congenital occurs due to embryonic embryonic cells, epidermal cells resting in middle ear or tympanic. So the more common site where this congenital, where this embryonic epidermal cell rests, or where this congenital cholesteatoma occurs, common sites are three main sites. First is middle ear cleft, then second is cerebellopontine angle, and the third last is middle ear cleft, cerebellopontine angle, and the third last is apex of petrous bone. So this was about congenital. Now we'll discuss how does the primary acquired cholesteatoma occurs. Primary acquired cholesteatoma. We'll discuss about pathogenesis. What happens? Suppose the eustachian tube is obstructed. Eustachian tube obstruction. What will it, suppose this is the middle here, I have a stitching tube over here. Suppose this eustachian tube is obstructed. Here we have tympanic. So what happens? Negative pressure is created in middle ear. In this middle ear, negative pressure will be created. Then what happens? Attic or posterior superior retraction pocket is seen. What is retraction pocket? Suppose this is a tympanic membrane, this is the middle ear cleft. Okay, due to negative pressure, what happens? There is an outgrowth of tympanic membrane inside the middle ear cleft, like this, which increases continuously. This is known as retraction pocket. So, attic or posterior superior retraction pocket is seen. This leads to primary acquired cholesteatoma, because the tympanic membrane is growing abnormally in different another region where it should not be present. What cholesteatoma is? So this is primary acquired cholesteatoma. Another way how this acquired cholesteatoma occur is, suppose a patient is having any subclinical infection in middle ear. So what will happen? This will result in metaplasia of middle ear mucosa. This will lead to primary acquired cholesteatoma according to Sadeh's theory. Then the last, what happens? Due to subclinical infection, we may see proliferation of basal cells. That is hyperplasia of basal cells, which will lead to cholesteatoma. That is the primary acquired. This proliferation of basal cells will lead to cholesteatoma, and this is according to Riude's theory. So this was how primary acquired cholesteatoma occurs. Till now what we have discussed, what is cholesteatoma, what are in cholesteatoma, its theory of genesis, different theory of genesis, congenital, Wittmax, Habermann's, Riude's, Sadeh's, etc. We discuss about the classification, how we have two, congenital and acquired. We discuss about the pathogenesis of congenital, primary acquired. Now let's discuss about the secondary acquired cholesteatoma. We are discussing the pathogenesis. We already said that secondary cholesteatoma, it occurs due to it is because of the previous history of perforation in the tympanic membrane. Suppose we have a patient with perforation in tympanic membrane. So what will happen? Recurrent infection through what? Because of perforation. As we discussed there, due to clinical infections, due to infection, it leads to metaplasia of middle ear mucosa. So once again, due to repeated infections through perforation, we'll see metaplasia of middle ear mucosa. metaplasia of medullary macrophage. This will lead to cholesteatoma, that is secondary acquired cholesteatoma. This was according to Sadeh's theory. One more pathogenesis due to which secondary acquired cholesteatoma occurs. Suppose a patient is having acute necrotizing otitis media. So what happens in otitis media? Usually we see perforation. It may be central, it may be marginal or active. So due to necrotizing media, we'll see perforation. What kind of perforation? Large, central or marginal. So due to otitis media, necrotizing otitis media, we'll see central, large central or marginal perforation. This will lead to epithelial margination. Epithelial margination because of perforation. And we have already discussed that according to Habermann's theory, that is due to epithelial invagination, we'll see cholesteatoma. So this is the another pathogenesis, how the secondary acquired cholesteatoma occurs. This cholesteatoma is a very, it expands further, and it has a very lethal capacity of destructing the surrounding bones and tissue. So in short, we'll discuss which bones can be affected and how it can expand. So expansion, it may expand and invade the surrounding tissue or organs. Tissues. So if it expands backward, it will affect mastoid antrum, auditus, and further mastoid bone too. If it goes downward, it may invade mesotympanum. If it invades medially, then it may affect the incus or handle of medius. So this is how it expands. It has a property, it can destruct bone. So cholesteatoma may expand and destruct bones. So the bones which can be destroyed are first, if it is going medially, suppose this is the middle ear, if it is going, cholesteatoma occurs naturally here. If it is going medially, it will destroy the ossicular bones. So ossicular bone. If it invades more medially, it may go to inner ear and destroy the bony labyrinth. It may destroy the tegment tympani. Sinus plate. And canal of facial nerve. This all destruction of bones may lead to severe complications like labyrinthitis, vitrocitis, and many more. So this was all about cholesteatoma. What is cholesteatoma? Cholesteatoma is an abnormal skin growth Okay, it develops in the middle ear cavity, just behind the eardrum. It consists of two part matrix, which consists of keratinized squamous epithelium. Then we have the central white mass, which is the keratin debris. Then there are many theories of its origins. Then we have classification, congenital and acquired. In acquired, we have two types, primary and secondary. In both, we have discussed how the pathogenesis occurs, and then its expansion that and the bones which it can destroy if it is invading further. So that was all about cholesteatoma. Thanks for watching our video. Please like, share, and subscribe my channel, Medi Simplified. Thank you.